Hey everyone, this is Hauke Kite-Powell. I'm with the Marine Policy Center at the Woods Hole Oceanographic Institution. And we work at the Marine Policy Center on marine resource management issues broadly, including fisheries and aquaculture, and marine environmental topics, including ocean acidification. I want to amplify on some of the things that John and Bärbel have said, focusing in particular on shellfish, because as John mentioned, they are among the most vulnerable and likely to be affected. The reason, of course, is, as Bärbel pointed out, the fact that a lower pH in the ocean makes it more difficult for calcifying organisms to build their shells and skeleton, and it particularly affects their survival in early life stages. And this is a problem not just for the ecological integrity of the systems, but for human beings too, who rely on these species for income and for nutrition in many parts of the world. Calcifying shellfish, like oysters, make different forms of calcium carbonate to build their shells. And oysters, for example, build their shells out of a form of calcium carbonate called aragonite early on in their life, and then later switch to making calcite. And it turns out that this is a problem for juvenile early life stage shellfish, because the aragonite form of calcium carbonate is less stable and more vulnerable to dissolution in low pH environments. And this is one of the reasons why larvae and early life stage forms of shellfish are particularly susceptible to these kinds of ocean chemistry changes. John mentioned the concept of coastal acidification, and this is important when thinking about shellfish, because most shellfish farming and harvesting takes place in nearshore coastal waters. And in those waters, the chemistry of seawater is much more dynamic than it is typically in the open ocean. And the reason for that is that biological activity, in particular marine plant life, is heavily concentrated in the coastal oceans. And plants during the day will absorb CO2 from the seawater in the process of photosynthesizing. And when they do that, they decrease the concentration of CO2 in the seawater and thereby raise the pH. At night, when the photosynthesis shuts down, but other kinds of biological respiration continue, CO2 in the coastal waters rises notably, and the pH declines. And so coastal waters generally have a much more variable pH regime than open ocean waters. That variability is amplified in places where people put a lot of additional nutrients into coastal waters, because that amplifies plant growth. In extreme cases, leads to algal blooms and things like that. And that, in turn, amplifies the cycling of high and low pH conditions over daily and seasonal timescales. And so the coastal acidification story is more complicated than that in the open ocean. And this is relevant particularly to coastal shellfish operations, of course. There are also, as both John and Bärbel mentioned, regional variations in these conditions. For example, the Gulf of Maine waters in New England are particularly acidic naturally already. And this is an issue not just in the nearshore shellfish communities, but also for species like sea scallops, which are wild and on the seabed naturally in conditions often that are already close to the limit of what calcifying organisms like sea scallops can tolerate. And so in some of the locations, small additional changes in ocean pH could have dramatic effects in the coming decades on the viability of those biological stocks. This is a summary of results from lab experiments on the effect of lower pH conditions on a variety of marine species. A paper by Gledhill and colleagues is similar to some of the results that John presented. Again, it's the calcifying organisms, the mollusks in particular, that show the most clear pattern of negative effects. For other species, the effects are less severe or unclear. But an important point also is that people notice differences in subpopulations in the way they respond to lower pH conditions. And that may have to do with the fact that the coastal pH regime is so dynamic, and different subpopulations may adapt and evolve in different ways in response to that. If you look globally at seafood production, very rough numbers, you can see that shellfish in aggregate account for about a quarter or so of the annual value of seafood production around the world. And this is just here a quick note to illustrate the scale of the potential vulnerability of seafood supply over the course of the coming century if conditions really become significantly inhospitable to these animals in large parts of the global ocean. People are looking at global models, as John said, of ocean pH change from the present conditions to what's likely to persist at the end of the century. And for shellfish and other marine organisms, what probably matters is the time point, roughly speaking, where the ocean chemistry conditions leave the envelope that these species have been used to living in for the recent historical past. And the time at which that's projected to happen in the models varies from location to location around the globe. But you can do this analysis and see where conditions will change outside of the envelope that local populations of marine organisms have been used to, so to speak. And you can see that these changes will happen in most parts of the world over the course of the coming century, some places sooner than others. I want to just quickly mention two other assessments that you may find interesting. There was a study published recently by Sarah Cooley and colleagues on the likely effect of acidifying sea conditions on the U.S. scallop fishery. And that includes not just the biogeochemical analysis and the scallop biological submodel, but also a model of the fishery, the socioeconomic component, that attempts to model how the fishery would likely respond to these changes that are coming. It includes estimates of how the scallop growth and survival will be affected by future ocean conditions. There's still some uncertainty about this, but people are doing a lot of experimental work now to help nail this down. And what the modeling efforts concluded is that certainly by roughly the middle of this coming century, we should expect to see, under the RCP 8.5 emission scenario that John described before, a significant effect on scallop biomass and on the revenue of the scallop fishery from ocean acidification changes. One other study to mention quickly is one by Ekstrom and colleagues that tries to look at the vulnerability and resilience of fishing communities around the United States in response to these kinds of effects. And so how well a fishing community can respond to or adapt to these sorts of changes depends not just on the biogeochemistry and the biology of the local fish and shellfish stocks, but also the capacity of that community technologically, economically, and socially to adapt to the changes that are coming. And what they find is a high degree of variability, not just in the biogeochemical and physical effects from ocean acidification, but also in the likely ability of fishing communities impacted by this to adapt and respond. And finally, you can look at that on the global scale too. There are big differences in the extent to which countries around the world rely on mollusk harvests for protein or for economic value. And if you combine that sort of information with the likely rate at which conditions will change in the coastal waters of those countries and the economic and technical wherewithal of the fishing populations there to adapt to this, you can assess the vulnerability of different countries to these impacts in the future. So what can we do about this? I want to just highlight four possible things that could be done. The first one, and probably a most general one, is we should try hard to limit coastal acidification by reducing the nutrient loading that makes eutrophication and other negative effects happen in coastal waters, and that amplifies the cycles of low pH and low oxygen conditions in coastal waters. Those kinds of steps to limit nutrient inputs to coastal waters can go a long way to making it easier for shellfish species and others there to withstand the changes in broader ocean chemistry. A second possibility, particularly around shellfish farms, is to influence local water chemistry to buffer it, effectively raising the pH around shellfish farms. And one way to do that is to grow large quantities of marine plants in the vicinity of the shellfish farms. Again, these plants absorb carbon dioxide during photosynthesis and effectively raise the pH in the water around them. So people are beginning to experiment with that. Another possibility is to move shellfish hatcheries and farms away from the nearshore waters where the effects are often most traumatic and low pH conditions cause the biggest problems. Some of this has already happened in the Pacific Northwest, where some shellfish growers have moved their hatcheries out of Puget Sound to Hawaii. And a fourth possibility is to select in shellfish farming for populations that prove to be more resilient to low pH and other stresses. So to summarize, I think it's pretty clear now that ocean acidification is a significant potential threat to many marine organisms, particularly calcifying organisms, including mollusks and corals. The effects are often species and location specific, so it's difficult to generalize about the specific things that are likely to happen. We need to think, as John emphasized, about not just pH, but multiple stressors that will accompany climate change. And we need to keep in mind the differences between open ocean conditions and the much more highly variable coastal acidification scenarios. The economic values globally that are potentially at risk from effects of ocean acidification on shellfish are significant. And there are a range of adaptation and mitigation measures that ought to be studied to see how we can respond to this, because even if the world gets serious about carbon emissions, we will be living with ocean acidification effects for the next century at least. And with that, I'm going to hand it back to Cassie.